Can you hear me? Okay. Good morning, everybody. And I know this was a challenging task to organize given the logistics that happened along the way, but I'm very happy to see the number of people that are here today. So we are here because we are all very fond of the signal processing discipline, the discipline that, like we say there in our tagline, powers almost everything we do today. We are the hidden intelligence behind much of the devices that you are using today. And my role here is to explain to you, as a society that represents this field, where we are, where do we want to go, and what are the challenges along the way, and why do we need your help. So I hope that you have downloaded the app, because we thought that since about 10 to 15% of our membership base is sitting in this room, why don't we engage them in some questions and collect some useful information from you? Because we need your feedback. Our society runs mainly with the help of volunteers. We have about over 1,000 active volunteers who run your editorial boards, who run your conferences, who sit on technical committees. So we very much depend on people like you and me. And you are going to see in what ways, okay? So, this is the Signal Processing Society, and as the tagline says, we are the science, the hidden science behind your digital life. And I like very much the line tag that the conference is using because it helps support this message. So before I start, what happened? Okay, so that was unwanted disturbance. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers. This was not an easy conference to organize given the logistics that we have to go through in a short time span. They had to move the conference from one location to another. I have attended conferences before in South Korea in Seoul, and I have no doubt in my mind that it would have been a perfect conference. They have superb infrastructure, hospitable people, and I'm very confident that the society sooner or later is going to take one of its major conferences back to South Korea. So thank you very much for working with us and being so patient with us and organizing such a great event. And thank you for the co-chairs and the program committee of the conference. Okay. Now, this conference has been so well organized that they did very well financially. We are not in the business of making money. We are in the business of helping our membership. So we have decided that we are going to share back the overhead that we obtain to support our student members. So if you are a society, a student member of our society, you are going to get the student membership back, okay, for this conference. And also, in support of the Seoul Signal Processing Chapter, given the disturbance that occurred in moving ICAST from one location to another, we would like to support you, we would like to support your activities, and part of the funds that we made are going to go to this chapter. Okay, so thank you very much for all your help, and this is a society that's open to students, and that's one way by which we are going to help students, and there is more coming along the way. So this is the test. If you downloaded the app, could you please take a second to answer this question? Is this your first ICASP? Yes or no? It's a very simple question. Okay, but it's very useful for us to know. Can you please take a second to answer that question, and then we're going to see the results on this screen. So, yeah, it was, okay, she will explain to you. Okay. So why don't we show the results? So 52% say that this is their first ICAST. That's an impressive number. I did not expect to have this many new people attending ICAST, so that's a good indication of interest in the conference. And I'm happy to see that 50% come back. Okay. So this is a good number to write down. Caroline, please take notes. Okay, so let's move on. This is a very special year for our society. We are commemorating our 70th birthday this year. You may not know that the Signal Processing Society was founded back in 1948 under a different name as the Professional Group on Audio, part of the Institute of Radio Engineers. And then 15 years later, in 1963, they grouped together with the American Institute of Electrical Engineers to form what's now the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, the IEEE. So we are 70 years old. Actually, we are the very first IEEE society to be formed, so you should be proud of that. And today we are the fourth largest. Okay, we have about 16,500 members and 194 chapters all over the world. And not only that, we are leaders within IEEE. Many of our volunteers have leadership positions in IEEE, including the future IEEE President Jose Mora. My good friend Jose Mora is sitting somewhere here, over there, so we should congratulate him. He will be the next IEEE President. Okay. And he was our former president, and I'm happy that he's sitting here because he's going to hear some suggestions during the presentation, okay? Okay. Now, I'm going to show you how the society is organized. We have an executive committee. These are the current members of the executive committee. Every other year or so, we elect new members. We will be electing a new vice president for technical directions during this ICAST. Very dedicated individuals. We have our president-elect, the next president of the society, sitting right here, Ahmed Tofiq. And we have our vice presidents, all of them sitting around here in charge of publications, conferences, technical directions, memberships, and so forth. So this is the body that runs the society at first, essentially on a day-by-day basis. But there are many, many other boards and committees and many volunteers involved in running the society, members of boards of governors, members of editorial boards, editors-in-chief, members of technical committees. You just see some faces there. Of course, I cannot afford to include all of them there. We have a board of governors, the awards board, conferences board, publications board, and the list keeps going on and on. So this is a very dynamic society, a very active society, and there are many opportunities for you to get involved if you so desire. And you may not know, but there is an invisible layer behind us that really makes this society run. We have a very efficient office of dedicated volunteers and staff who are sitting here, and you'll be seeing them later today. And these are their names over there. Managers in charge of running the day-to-day operations of the society in terms of publications, conference activities, membership activities, and so forth. Okay, so these are the people that you interact with almost on a daily basis when you submit your papers to our journals or conferences. So this is how the society is organized on a very high level. What about our membership? Okay, so we have about 16,000 plus members, and I would like to give you an idea of how we are organized. You can see there, 40% of them come from the US, 27% from Asia, and 27% from Europe, Africa, and the Middle East. And this is my first suggestion to the next IEEE president. I think it would be very useful not to blend Europe, Africa, and the Middle East together, as you're going to see in the numbers, because this hides some dynamics. I think it would be useful to have separate regions for these areas, as the numbers are going to show you later. Okay? But anyway, this is how our membership base is distributed. So I usually have to have an equation in my presentation. So this is my equation. I looked at these numbers, and I wanted to know if they were meaningful. How do they compare? If in Canada, this is a large country, we have about 500 people only, and I expected more, but I looked and I did these calculations. I looked at the populations for each region, how many people, how large the population is in each region, and then I divided the number of members by the population in that region. And I call that fraction P. It's a very small number, of course, but let's call it P, right? If you go to Central and South America, it's actually the same ratio. Europe, Middle East, and Africa, it's twice as that. Canada, it's 14p, and the US, it's 20p. So here you have, Canada, you have an opportunity to win this game. Just add 200 more members, and you will become the most represented region in our membership base. Okay, only 200 more members. Okay, so this is one way to look at it. What about gender distribution? This is something where we need to work more, okay? We have about 80% male members, 9% female members, and the 11% is left unspecified. Okay? Regardless of how you look at it, this tells you that we need to do better in attracting more female members to our society. But again, I want you to look more into these numbers. So I did some research and I found some interesting articles. So if you look into, there is much work and much research on attracting more female members to the STEM fields, mathematics, engineering, technology, and so forth. If you look at the numbers in the US, there are 70% of women in electrical engineering. That's where most of our members probably come from. 25% of them in the STEM fields. So we are at 9%, so we can at least double that percentage, number one. Number two, because we are an international organization, if you look at the slide on the right, what that is, that's a plot showing you countries on the horizontal line, you have the percentage of women in the STEM fields in these countries. On the vertical line, you have equality, gender equality, for example, equal pay, job opportunities. And what this article is saying that there is a trend, the lower the gender equality index is, the higher the percentage of women in the STEM field. That's what this article is discovering. But to me, what I look at it, what's more interesting to me, and this comes back to that idea of perhaps giving Africa and the Middle East a separate region, because if you look at this plot, you're going to see that the locations where you have the most women in the STEM fields are actually in the Middle East and Africa. Okay, so that number gets masked when you blend them together. And we have chapters in these regions, and this is a good place where we can perhaps attract more women members into our society. Of course, we need to do it broadly across all regions, but I'm just sharing with you some statistics. This doesn't mean, the fact that we have 9% of women in our membership base, it doesn't mean that we are not a society that's open to women participation in our activities. Our immediate past president, my good friend Rabah Guardo, is sitting here, right? She is very active in society affairs and IEEE affairs and many other women volunteers who occupy leadership positions in our society. And if you are a woman volunteer sitting here, you are more than welcome to also participate in these activities. There are many others, but given the size of the slide, I couldn't show all of them. And we have events that are targeting the female membership, for example. There is the luncheon coming, for women in signal processing that I invite all of you to attend, and it will be talking about how do you become a fellow and what does it take to become a fellow, okay? So before I move on, I would like to ask you another question. Okay, let's take a small break and ask you another question, okay? So what should we do to increase women membership in our society? A, organize events run by and for women members. Have mentorship, develop a mentorship program for student members and also female members. Have more leadership positions to women members. Give more society awards to women members or all of them, all the above. So what do you think? Please vote. Okay, so maybe we can see the results now. All the above. And B, mentorship program, interesting, mentorship program. We discussed that in a recent retreat and that was top on our agenda. If Nico is sitting here, so that's a good feedback. Mentorship program and all the above. Okay, very good, very useful feedback for us to know. Okay, so let's move on. Let's look at industry. This is another area where we need to do better, okay? If you look at our membership distribution across the world, it's almost half-half from academia and from industry. Within the US, two-thirds are from industry, and one-third is from academia, okay? However, I will ask you this question. How many of you sitting here are from industry? So let's please answer this question. How many of you are faculty students from industry or other? Okay. Okay, so let's look at the result. Student, so 25% from industry. So we are not able to attract a proportion of members from industry that's consistent with the numbers I showed you there. So we need to do more. This is an area where we are working very hard to try to attract more members from industry and organize events that target industry members more, okay, methodically. But there are events that we organize at this conference where you can interact with people from industry, networking events, for example, the Young Professionals Reception is one of them, the Student Career Luncheon is another of them, where students can go and talk to and be interviewed by people from industry. Okay. And we are going to be doing more of that. So that's our membership base. So let's see now how engaged you are in society activities. Okay, we have the numbers. Okay, how engaged you are in society activities. In the most recent membership for the Board of Governors, only 18% of you voted. Okay? And if you look at all the votes received, 28% of them came from the US, 27% from Asia, 36% from Europe, and so forth. Okay? So, but this is one way to look at it. There is another way to look at it, which I find more interesting. This way. I took how many votes I received from each region and I divided it from the number of members we have from that region. So you can see that only 12% of the members in the US vote. But the region that wins this game is South and Central America. Even though we only have 500 members there, they are very active. They participate in voting. So again, Canada has a chance to win this game. If you just add a few more members and vote a little bit more. Okay, so this is how we are. Okay. But again, perhaps this means we need to engage our members more. We need to show you that we are relevant, and we need to show the organizations around us that we are also relevant. Okay, that's why we are organizing many activities, and there are initiatives that are already ongoing to try to address these issues. So these are some high-level goals we have for the society. We would like to be open to students. We would like you to be part of us. We would like to reach the industry more vigorously. We would like to expand our educational opportunities and provide this service to you. Right now, we provide services in terms of publications and conferences. Perhaps we can also help with educational activities. And we would like to enrich our publication and conference experience. For example, the ICASP of today is not different from the first ICASP I attended. You go there, you have plenary talks, you have sessions, you meet people, it's all very good. But this has been a long time span and the experience has been largely the same. Okay, publications, you submit your paper, it is reviews, you get reviews back, you get angry at them, you send your revision back, but that experience has not changed. But everything around us is changing. Okay, so we are thinking about that. Now, it's very easy for you to get involved because we have many things to do. So please, if you are interested in serving, just talk to any of our volunteer leaders or send an email to this account which we created. Just send an email. And I promise you that I will be leaving that account, okay? It forwards to my regular account. Send suggestions. Just write and say you are interested in getting involved. And we are going to find something for you to help us with, okay? So this is another thing we are doing for the students. Starting in the next membership cycle, which is around August this year, this will become the $1 student society for, okay, moving forward. That's it. If you are a student, you just cost you $1 to be a member. So tell your students and tell your friends. Okay? This is the $1 society. Okay? Also, at this conference, we will be discussing in our executive committee meeting and in the Board of Governors and the conferences board. Fernando, my good friend, who is in charge of the conference's activities, we have been talking about making tutorials accessible to students and perhaps all of our members at nominal fees, okay? We would like you to come here and get a service from us, okay? So this is, again, something that we will be working on. So tell your students and tell your friends, okay? And there are much more that we need to do for our members, and I'm going to show you. There are some initiatives that are already in motion with several volunteers leading the efforts. For example, Ahmed, who is sitting here, is working on developing a new newsletter that focuses on innovations around us that are powered by signal processing. Nikos, who will be arriving later, will be developing an app an app that integrates everything that happens in this society, conferences, your publications, your reviews, okay, your seminars, your webinars. You can access everything through that app, okay, and many other things that we will be doing, and you will be hearing about us. And there have been many other things going on, starting under the leadership of my predecessor, Rabab, who is sitting here. She did lots of good work in developing first-party videos that are addressed to high school students or early university students, telling them what signal processing is. You can access these videos on YouTube in different languages. You have in Chinese, in English, in Arabic, I think in Spanish. So there is lots of things going on, but we need help. You know, developing videos like this takes time. You have to write the script, you have to think of a story, of an application, and so forth. So that's where we need help. So one of the other things we are doing for you, okay, is the following. If you look at where our events are concentrated, conferences, workshops, that's where it is. Okay? There is a large area where that remains sparsely populated. Right? You hardly see events there. From time to time you have an event. So we want to change that dynamics, because if you look at where our 194 chapters are distributed, a large proportion of them is very active exactly in this area where you don't have many of our events taking place. So to address that, we have decided to go global. So our society is going global. If you cannot come to us, we are going to you. Okay? Not every member can afford to come to ICAS or to ISIL. So we want you, we want to take our events to you. If you are a local chapter, a professor in university, local industry, you can apply to organize a local meeting, or a forum, a panel with industry, or a summer school for students, and we are going to help you. If you have a good proposal, we are going to give you money to help you organize these events. Okay, so, and this is already running, and this is your opportunity to become more engaged, okay? So these are the events, and you can read about them online. We also give awards to our chapters, and this year the best chapter award is being shared by the Santa Clara Valley chapter and the Vancouver chapter. And since the World Cup is coming, that's the trophy that you're going to get. Okay, so this is a very serious award. Okay, I'm going to skip some of these. We serve you in many other ways, not just through conferences, but also through publications. We publish many journals, and just to think of the amount of work that going into running these journals. Each one of them has an editorial board with 50 or 60 people or more, right? So lots of volunteers are putting free time into analyzing and reviewing your papers. So whenever you get a request to review a paper, please be aware that others have been reviewing your papers as well. So this is very important to know. This is the trend of how our publications have been doing. You can see that we are publishing more and more papers this time. There you see. Now, when I saw this graph, I was very, very happy, because it reminded me of the time when I served as editor-in-chief, which was right there when this curve started going up. So I feel very happy about this trend. So that's the total number of pages we publish every year, about 22,000 pages. So this leads to reviewer overload. Should we consider new publication modes? Interesting enough, the way we publish science, assess science, produce science today is somewhere between what Galileo experienced and what Fourier experienced, even though this is the 21st century. If you want to know why, you can read my next message. That's the title. It's coming up in the May or June issue of the IEEE Signal Processing Magazine. And I tell you there why the way we are vetting science today is somewhere in between, and how we can do better by using the power of the online medium. Okay? Still, our publications are doing very well, and here you can see the impact factors on top in comparison to other journals that some of our members publish in. So you can see that the Signal Processing Magazine is doing very well, and the other transactions also are doing very well. Okay? So now what about the future? Okay? What about the future? So like I said, the future is today. The trends around us are changing, and we need to respond to that. And the value of signal processing, everything that's going around us, needs to be highlighted. This is the diagram that I like, that my good friend Nikos was trying to explain to me what signal processing is, and he sent me this email. Right? So everybody talks about data science, So move them apart and put signal processing in between. Data comes in, science comes out. Okay? That's a good way of explaining what signal processing does. You process the data, extract information from the data. So we have a very important role to play in all these areas that you see there marked in red. People are very interested in brain sciences, social sciences, data-driven sciences, smart technology, and signal processing has a role to play in all of these areas, and we need to make sure that people understand that. We also need to change your experiences, because the new generation of members that you see here, you have grown up in a different environment. You have grown up attached to your devices to easy access to information online, whether right or wrong, but that's how you grew up. So we need to be able to embed that experience into the way we interact with you. And it's very important for us to recognize, and also for IEEE to recognize, that we live in different times. Many industries are disappearing because it took them a long time to recognize the power of the online medium. You have businesses closing up. Even newspapers, right? Most of us nowadays access our news online, okay? Even TV stations, video rental networks, many businesses around us have been affected seriously, and the same applies to IEEE. We really need to be aware of this trend and explore the power of the online media much more actively, including our society. So this is one activity we are doing now, and Maria Greco, my good friend Maria, is sitting somewhere here. She's the editor-in-chief of the Resource Center. We would like to create a single point of entry for everything signal processing. Videos, seminars, preprints, software, code, so that you don't have to think. Whenever you think about needing something related to signal processing, let me go and check what they have on the Resource Center. So Maria is working on developing this interface, okay? And you can talk to her, there she is, and also to Nikos. And there are many other things that we would like to develop. We need to create a personality for our society. We need to create history for our society and attach signal processing to prominent names around us, okay? Because this is a very rich society with a very rich history. I like what the Control Society has been doing. Over there you see a video that you can see on YouTube. An interview between Franklin and Sadek. And those of you who know them, right, these are two prominent names. Unfortunately, both of them passed away, but their memory is there. You can go there and see how they contributed to the field. Now, we need to do something like that, create our history. So we need volunteers if you are interested in helping. Okay. And this is the integrated experience we'll be developing for you, okay? Creating an app that integrates all of your experiences throughout our society. So this is a question that I would like to ask you. I'm almost done with my presentation, but I would like to collect your feedback on this. If you are a member of our society, what is it that you most value about your membership? Free access to our periodicals, ability to network, discounts on conference fees, access to newsletters, other? So let's look at the results. Which one? See, discounts on conference fees, interesting. Okay, so it was a good idea to give you money back. Okay. What's the next one? B, network. Okay, very good. So that's very useful information. So Karen, you're taking notes. Okay, very good. Now, a few other things to create this personality. Okay, and a sense of community, and that we are also a society with history, we have decided to name our awards. Moving forward, probably starting from next year, our awards will have names attached to them. Rather than being called the Society Award, it will be called the Norbert Wiener Society Award. The same thing for the Education Award, named after Gauss. The Technical Achievement Award, named after Shannon and Nyquist. And the Meritorious Service Award, named after Bedanek. He was the first president of our society and also a recipient of the Medal of Science from the US government. Okay, so he's a very distinguished individual and he is being honored in that manner. Okay, but there are other awards also that are already named after individuals at the IEEE level, and some of them will be given today by José Mora to the recipients. This is another activity that we are doing. We are in the process of modernizing the society logo. We ask you for input, so if you have an opportunity, suggest ideas. We are going through that. Many other societies have modernized their logo, and we are thinking about doing the same thing for our society. So that's an overview of where we are and where we want to go. I don't have much more time to spend talking about this. If you are interested in watching it, you can go to the society website. Okay, so thank you very much for listening. Now I should invite the chair of our award board, Bjorn Watterson, to